Guide through Merkwood. I'm your host, Mike Duner Muldoon, broadcasting live from Mayapack, New York, Merkwood One Studios. I have a very special announcement. I announced it on Facebook over the holiday weekend, but we have Jamie Martinez co-hosting the Duner's Guide through Merkwood on Mondays going forward. Jamie from Los Angeles.
Hey, you know what?
Welcome, man.
Hey, man, it's your show. I'm your co-driver. That's it.
Yeah, man. So Mondays, we had a lot of fun last week on episode 25. That was a good time.
Yeah.
I don't think we've gone a day without talking since then, have we, brother?
No. We're getting some good guests, but I wonder who did that. It wasn't me. It must have been that guy upstairs.
You know? Well, let's talk about how we met, right? So actually, I did meet without any – well, I guess it was the spirit of the universe that brought me to Ken Tucker, right? My blues brother from another mother in Terre Haute, Indiana. And then he led me to you, right? So hey, Ken, how you doing out there? Thanks for bringing
I love Ken. Ken's my brother in arms, man. And you know what? We're still working – Ken, we're still working on that UK tour, so – I'll let you know what's going on.
Hope it happens.
Hope it happens with COVID. We say a prayer. Let's go.
Right. Also, I want to say hi to Sarah Parada up in Kingston, New Paltz area. So, Jamie, I sent you over some of her stuff.
Yeah. You know what? I was listening to her music. She's really deep, man. She's got what it takes. She's got the looks. She's got the songs. You know what? I kind of like her. I think I'm going to.
She's great.
I'll send some people upstate to put her on a tour. How's that?
That sounds good. I'm sure she'd love that. I've been listening to her older catalog, and there's a song, Pavement, that's just awesome. So check out her older catalog.
Jerry Marotta.
She's working with Jerry and Tony Levin up in Dreamland.
Oh, I know Tony. Good man.
Yeah. Everybody knows who Tony Levin is, but you know him.
Yeah, the bald-headed guy with the Chapman stick bass.
That's it. That's the one and only. So, hey, Sarah.
Multi-talented.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Hell of a nice guy, too, if you have a chance to meet him.
I hope to
see him. Maybe I can get him for your show. Just don't tempt me.
So let's talk about the guests coming up, the programming this week that you helped me put together. On Wednesday's show, we have a gentleman named Neil Hamilton. Neil was what an amazing artist and just force of nature. I would say Neil is. I've only met him.
Neil's my boy, man. I mean, he really helped me when I was on tour with one of the major bands I toured with in Atlanta. It was my stop, and I introduced him to the other person you're gonna talk about, Rita Graham.
Yeah,
but let's talk about Neil. Neil is a 10-year Rock and Roll Hall of Fame photographer and from Cleveland area.
1996 to 2006.
Yeah, and not just that. I mean, look at this. Speaking of a little segue, this is what he painted, the Jimi Hendrix autograph
look at
for
that.
Me.
That's
and
gorgeous,
he really man. Helped me when I was on tour with Chris Pitts. He hosted us. Him and Rita hosted us. It's always nice to go to a city where you feel safe. And Atlanta's a great town, a big rock and roll town.
And his art, his rock portraits are just absolutely dynamite. His picture of Frank Zappa.
Extremely talented, equally a charming, nice
original,
man.
Original. His Miles Davis, his Peter Gabriel is just phenomenal.
Oh, yeah. I got them all right there. It's Paint Out Loud.
Paint Out Loud, the Neil Hamilton. Everybody check him out.
I would take it down, but it's up there. But next time I'll take it down. Hey, Neil. Hey, it's going to be great hearing your interview, man.
Yeah, I can't wait to talk to him. He painted guitar for Dave Navarro. He's just done so many cool things. So lots to talk to Neil about on Wednesday. And then on Thursday, we have the lovely, amazing Rita Graham coming on.
The diva. I represent her, you know, for 5 years. I met her in Chicago. I was hanging out with the Dixons, you know, the Dixon family, the original Chicago blues all-stars. And they invited me to a show at the old school in Old Town, or I forget the name of it. You guys know it's really popular. And Rita opened for Taj Mahal with Sammy Blue. And that's when I met her. We connected. And I became her agent, you know, a few years later. And, you know, she's nothing but a charming lady. She'll tell you she was a Raylette. She'll tell you the Ray Charles stories that are just amazing.
Can't wait.
And there's
a
lot more to it. You know what? I'll let Rita talk about that.
Oh, yeah. So we'll be talking with the lovely Rita Graham on Thursday. Can't
Rita
wait.
Rita is my favorite, bro.
They're re-releasing some of her older albums, and she sent me a couple of the tracks. They're phenomenal. Her version of Georgia On My Mind, as you would imagine, stupendous. So we'll be digging that out and sharing that music with everybody. So looking forward to seeing Neil on Wednesday and Rita on Thursday. So it's going to be a good week.
That's correct.
I'm also working on a potential guest for after that, a friend of mine who attended Woodstock. right? So I'm the town I live in is about an hour and 20 minutes from Woodstock, which is now the Bethel Woods site. But back in 69, he actually made the trip up there, and he's got some stories to tell.
I know a few guys that done Woodstock. Do you know who Niles Preston is, the Knack bass player?
Yes, sure.
Okay, he's from Brooklyn. He's a good tribe member out here. Anyways, I'm good friends with him. He comes by our studio in Redondo Beach every once in a while. And he's really solid bass player. He told me stories about going to Woodstock. I go, that's pretty cool. I mean, I was only 5 years old when that happened. I don't even think you're a sperm in your dad's
field. No, I was born in 75, man. I wasn't born yet.
Yeah, well, you're an old soul, bro. You're good.
So the one piece of his story that's missing, it's missing from 90% of people that went to Woodstock, is they didn't make it to Monday morning. Right. Something special happened Monday morning, which we've all
listened
to.
Let me see. It was raining.
I think there was some Gypsy Sun and Rainbows that came out on stage and just kind of leveled. It was only about 10,000 people that were left. So my buddy Brian didn't make it to that point, but I want to seg that in. So my show's about Frank Zappa and my love and him being my be all. So Jamie, you as the co-host now, your boy's Mr. Hendrix, right? So let's talk about Jimmy a bit.
When I first listened to him, I was 10 years old. My uncle said, hey, I want you to put this on. At the time, I was listening to the Beatles and I think Sugar Sugar by the Archies or some shit. I don't remember.
Good song.
You know, so I was kind of musically confused. I needed some direction. So my uncle goes, I want you to listen to this. You know, dude, I listen to Are You Experienced? I go, wow.
Yeah.
I go, and he's black. I mean, that was like my first thing. But then I did his history. Because in the old days, we used to go to the library and you had the big encyclopedia of rock. You've probably seen those things at thrift stores. So I would go through that. You know, and I go, okay, wow, he's from Seattle and he's part Cherokee. I go, then I start listening to his music. I go, I can feel the tribal beats. And I want to thank Ross, can I name
Sal? Yeah, man, thank you.
Okay, Ross Romero, who happens to be Cesar Chavez's cousin out here in California. He told me about the tribal beats. And I said, and it always stuck with me when he told me. He reiterated it today. Because look at his songs. His songs were amazing. He was so ahead of the curve. I'll just say one more thing and I'll let you take over. I guess when he was touring with the Isley Brothers, he would steal the show. So the Isley Brothers, this is the inside story. Isley Brothers said, hey, Jimmy, man, you got to go on your own. They're watching you. They're not watching our show.
Right.
So you can, but that was a good way of humbling, saying, dude, start your own show, start your own gigs. And Jazz Chandler of the Angels, picked it up from there. And he was on to England, you know?
Yeah. And I've been thinking about it over the last 24 hours since we decided for this to be the topic. And the one thing I just keep landing on, Jamie, is I can't think of anybody that's changed the overall way everybody approaches an instrument. You know what I mean? So Jimi Hendrix did something that everybody that's touched a guitar since, you kind of have to have. Like in math, you know, there's addition and subtraction and algebra. Like Hendrix is another piece where you have to have that if you touch the instrument. You could say
he brought sexuality.
Spirituality.
He's up there with Morrison, who brought the sex appeal to the guitar. Yep. Morrison brought the sex appeal to the lead singer, the leather pants, copies now, or just something in that vein. But also, what really makes Jimi Hendrix, he wrote his own songs. He was amazing. You know what? But the cover versions he did them on his own. And online with, I would say, Brian Ferry, who does his own versions of cover songs, but he makes it his own. Jimi Hendrix had that upside down Stratocaster. He was just so phenomenal. But you know, a guy like that, who's such an innovator, you know he's going to be a little off, you know, because anybody who's that intelligent, I've been around these guys, they're just in a different dimension and they're not normal.
100%.
But who likes normal? Shit, not me.
So two thoughts on that. So as far as the covers go, how about what he did with the Sgt. Pepper's? Right, so Sgt. Pepper's, they released it.
It's on the BBC. Look at it.
Like a week later, he played it live? Week later, he played it live?
Somebody burnt me a copy. So
that was pretty cool.
I don't know if I should do that. But Sgt. Pepper's. You know what? I guess the Beatles, I don't know if you heard the story. I think he was at the Rainbow Club with Speakeasy. He was having a gig. And the day Sgt. Pepper's was released, Jimmy surprised them and opened up with Sgt.
Pepper. That's why I brought it up, man. That's what I was talking about.
I don't know. Okay, well, now, what club was it at? Was I right? Was it at the Rainbow Speaking?
I don't remember the club. I just remember it was released, and within a day or two, Jimmy opened the show with it the next, you know.
And, I mean, not bad for a guy who just caught on. I mean, the Beatles are in a different old league, but, you know, it's like the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, the Doors, legacy acts, you know? Now, nobody will ever copy that, you know, ever.
Yeah, yeah. Interestingly, I was listening to a Zappa interview from later in his life earlier today. And so they asked him about Jimi Hendrix. And he told the story, which was hilarious. He said Jimmy came to his place in New York and then he walked in with Buddy Miles. And Buddy Miles proceeded to pass out immediately on the couch. Wow. Jimmy proceeded to do some interpretational dance, which caused the inner seam of his pants to rip. So Gail had to sew it up. And then on the way out, Jimmy woke Buddy up and they left. So that was Frank's first story he told about Jimmy. So the person came back and said, well, what about the music? And Frank's answer was interesting. He said, I really wish that someone had worked with Jimmy. Like that Jimmy had somebody, of course, Frank's thinking someone could kind of engineered him to get more work. So, you know, he specifically said someone to work with him and get his ideas into different instrumentations, into orchestras. And for a second, I just thought of, wow, imagine if Frank Zappa had been Jimi Hendrix's keeper for those years and got all that.
You know,
and was able to, I mean, it wouldn't have worked for so many reasons, but just the thought of it and what Jimmy could have done artistically could have been more, but it might have been changed, you know, what he did do. So it's fun to think about what could have been. And
yeah, I mean, think about it. I mean, think of Hendrix sitting and die in London. Just think of, like, he had another 10 years. I mean, what he would have been. I mean, he would probably sobered up, I would imagine, and he would be that spiritual guru everybody looks up to, still touring like a B.B. King did, you know. But guys like that, in my opinion, you know, they're just diehard. I mean, and people want to hear them, you know. Mm-hmm. The old blues guys, you know, I worked in Chicago with the Dixon family, you know, when I was there, my time there. And you know what? There's a lot of, you see a lot of blues in there. And like, I'll reiterate again, in Hendrix's music, you see a lot of tribal drums, you know, because he's Cherokee, he's part Cherokee. He's a very unique person. And on top of it, you know what? I mean, the guy was a fucking paratrooper too. I mean, the guy's a stud.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy, and he was a stud apparently to the women. Uh-huh. But you know what? We'll ask the plaster casters that one day.
There's artifacts out there to prove it, right? You know, Jamie, the one collaboration that I just it kills me that the world was robbed of was Jimi Hendrix and Miles Davis. And it was supposedly in the works. It was supposedly going to happen or in the ether.
Well, can I give you a side note on Miles Davis?
Gosh.
Vince, I got confirmation that Vince Wilhelm Jr., well, you know, his nephew's going to be on he wants to be on the show. So,
really?
He, you know, you can talk about Miles all day, but really quick, one more thing off Miles Davis. My girlfriend in Memphis, you know, my fiance, Karen, she's going to do a Betty Davis tribute. That was Miles' wife. She was the one that the crazy soul singer that was so ahead of her time. Mm-hmm. She brought in sexuality in the late 60s, early 70s. The story is she threw Miles Davis, his Italian clothes out the door and made him become a hippie. That's when he started dressing hip. And she's on the cover of he wanted to call Bitches Brew Witches Brew, but she said no. Call it Bitches Brew. Shit. You know, well, I can do this because you know what? I have a hot black girlfriend who knows how to do it. And she's from
and that brought the role John McLaughlin that period, who's one of my all-time Mahavishnu. Love him so much.
You know, I'll be honest with you. I mean, I've listened to Miles Davis a few times, but now I'm getting into it. I got my friend Ian. He said, he's going to bring me a copy of Bitches Brew. And I got my buddy John, obviously, talked about him when you interviewed me. You know, he lives here. He's got a copy, but you know him. He's a drummer.
You
got
to listen to the album Dig with Sonny Rollins. That's one of my favorites. The album Dig with Sonny Rollins. I love that album.
Well, I'm sure you can talk to Vince about that when you interview
him. So Vince is he's Miles' nephew?
Miles' nephew. He's a producer.
So he's Miles' nephew. So what? I think we should probably have him on Monday and have a nephew show.
Okay. Hey, remember, man, I signed a disclosure.
I didn't say nothing.
No, okay, but I'm just saying, you know what? If you want him on Monday, I'll get his email and I'll send it to you tomorrow, okay?
Yeah, cool, man. Cool.
He's interested. He's a very nice man, too. A very talented, humble guy from Southside Chicago, you know? And I've been in Chicago. I worked there for some years, you know, and I know that vibe, you know, and it's really cool. And he'll be great. And I think Rita's going to be great and Neil's going to be great.
Absolutely.
And, you've got some great guests coming up, man. You know,
I'm excited.
I'm happy for the show. I'm happy for our show.
It's great. They're just having a lot of fun, man. So back to Jimmy for a little while. When we decided to do it, you know, to make this a Hendrix episode, I've been going shopping at Big Jim Gibson's record store down in Buchanan, New York, frequently. Also producing Big Jim Gibson's podcast as well. Okay. So I went down the other day and I did a little shopping. And I restarted my vinyl collection, right? So I liquidated it 15, 20 years ago, went digital completely. Now
we all did
it.
That.
I got my little record player, first one in 25 years I've had. So,
I got one at Walmart, bro. I love it,
dude. That's where I got mine. It was half price at Walmart.
Man, I got like a, what is it? I got Vitrola? It right here.
Is it Vitrola?
Oh no, I got a Crosley.
Oh, I got a Vitrola. It was half price.
Mine was like $50.
Same here. It was like $59 half price.
That's so funny. I'm taking it. I ran home. I got my vinyl. I said, I told my receptionist, hold my call.
Yeah.
Go home. I want to be by my vinyl all day.
Yeah, so I've started from scratch. I had gotten rid of all my vinyl, right? So I've been repopulating it. So I hadn't bought any Hendrix records. And I went, I got about five of them. I have them all digitally, so it's not like I really need them, but I need it to hold the records. And this one, in particular, I'd like to talk about. Because this is
a Band of Gypsies from the Fillmore.
Just really affected me. Right? I think it's one of his best. Yeah, Fillmore, New Year's Eve.
That has Machine Gun on it, right?
Unbelievable version of Machine Gun on it. Unbelievable version. And I think as far as Jimmy's career, like he'd gone from the experience into the Woodstock band, the Gypsy Son of Rainbows, and then boiled it back down to the three. And this is just such an amazing piece.
Hey, I want to run something by you about Hendrix. I was just thinking about that. I was talking to my buddy about this the other day. I go, you know that song? My favorite song by Hendrix is Castles Made of Sand. Right? Mm. But isn't that like the first rap? The way he just presented it, being a fearless warrior, Indian chief. I won't go over 10 seconds because I don't want to pay for anything.
So, that's my favorite album. That's my absolute favorite. If I could pick one, Axis would be the one I would choose. That is.
Oh, Electric. Well, you know, Axis is awesome, man.
The cover, the
Crosstown Traffic,
the introduction. Oh my gosh, it goes everywhere.
Oh man, you know what? When I heard Foxy Lady, and you hear that guitar tone, you know something I really remember. I really love by him. I would say it's a deep cut, but first is Remember the Mocking. Remember, I love that song. Remember, it's just it's so simple, but it's so Hendrixy. It's like. It makes you want to cry, man. Or The Wind Cries Mary. Oh, I do that in karaoke.
No, do you? I don't know if I want to see that.
No, you're kidding me? I can't do 10 seconds or we're going to lose our show. So we'll leave it at that.
That'll have to be after happy hour. You do karaoke, right? If we're going to talk about favorite songs, mine would probably be a version is on here. It was originally released as the B-side of Stepping Stone. It kind of fell off. Isabella. And he played it at Woodstock. It's last song on War Heroes.
Wow, that's a deep cut. You know what? Song. I'll be honest with you. I'm gonna hear it today. You just schooled the master.
Such a good song. The reason it's in my heart is because Phish covered it back in '97. I think for the first time I was there. I don't remember. And it's one of those songs every Phish fan is trying to see, waiting to see. And
you know what? I never got into Phish because I'm a deadhead. So I just figured in the '90s I was more into like Dishwalla. REM. I went through phases, and then I got into Americana, then I got back into my hard rock, and then I got into R&B. You know, you go through phases.
Yeah.
Probably you do too.
I didn't like the Dead when I was in high school. I was just in punk and metal and hardcore Nirvana, right? I saw Nirvana 2 days after Nevermind came out in a bar. And then eventually I fell in love. I got to see Jerry once, luckily, with the Dead. But now I love him. I love him you love Phish.
I wasn't really a Nirvana guy to me, but they had moments and they were a great band. I mean, look at you got Dave Grohl. I mean, he made one of the biggest fucking bands around, Foo Fighters. I mean, that just how much talent was in that band. And Chris Novoselic, another great bass player. But you know what? All I know is this. You know what? I respect them a lot. I'm not saying I was a big fan, but you know what? They got some cool songs. I got it.
Yeah. Oh, Nirvana does for sure. Sure. Actually, I met Dave that night, the night I saw them. And after
Dave's a hell of a nice guy.
He was just hanging out.
Lemmy's funeral.
So nice.
I saw him at Lemmy's funeral. When Lemmy died, I was invite only and I got invited. This was like in December or January of 16 before I went to Chicago for a little time and to work. And Dave, I mean, I remember him from his Nirvana days and we talked a little bit. It was just really sad when Lem died, you know, because he's a hell of a nice guy. Not just that, dude. He was a man's man, you know? He was a last of a dying breed.
Where did he start, Jamie?
He started in Hawkwind.
Well, no, before that. Before he was even...
Oh, the Revolting Rock.
When he worked. Who does he work for? Who is he roadie for?
Oh, Jimi Hendrix.
There you go. That's it. There you go. It's all connected, man. It's all connected.
And you know, one thing about Lemmy, we have a lot in common. Now I have an English daughter. Oh, I want to give a shout out to my English daughter, Ruth. I just found out about her... just in November when I was working in Memphis. Dude, it's like a whirlwind. Everything checked out, blood test, everything, man. Wow. I just want to say
congratulations,
Ruth.
It's a girl.
Yeah, and she's beautiful. She's a model. And I'm like going, that came from me? Yes. Welcome to the Lucky Sperm Club, lady. All right.
So the apple can fall far from the tree. Thank God.
She's coming up. Yeah, you know what? I just want to. She's not feeling good. She's going through morning sickness. She's expecting a baby, and I just want to say how much I love you. We miss you. Everybody here in California loves you. All my family, extended family, friends are always asking about her. You're in good hands, Ruth. And you
Ruth, be well.
You're going to listen to this podcast, and we're going to put you on. You're going to talk about your mom.
Heck yeah! Heck yeah!
But I'm going to interview you. The master will interview you. That's it. I'm not going to say anything. That's nepotism. I don't know anything about that.
Okay, nephew. So, nephew, what are you doing next? What are you up to? What's going on with you, man? When are you getting to Memphis? What are you finding
out? I'm going to Memphis on the 20th. I'm gonna just shake it down. Gonna deal. I have an artist in Oxford, Mississippi, which is about 60 miles south. His name is Haggard Collins. He's a great blues guy. He's got a raspy voice. He's got great presence. You know, we're gonna build him up. Okay. Cool. Then I got deal with my Chris Pitts, who toured Australia last year. He's gonna be recording after this COVID stuff gets over. You know, with Manny Charlton, is a good friend of mine of the band Nazareth of Love Hurts fame and Hair of the Gog. He's got a studio in Spain. This is all in the future right now. But you know what? Future uncertain now. In recent times because of the COVID, but we're going to get it done. You know, technology maybe will help us on this one, but you know what? You know, it's going to be hard. I mean, it's tough out there, guys, you know, cover up. You know, I was very cavalier about it, you know, in the beginning, almost, you know, and almost to the point where it's like, I should have had it, you know, the way I was traveling and everything, but I'm very cautious now with it. Good. And, what I'm saying, man, I'm praying for everybody out there that has it, you know, and get well soon, man. Because we need you.
Yeah. And until you can't travel, come on our show. Give us a call. Drop us a line. You know, come talk to us about your music. And we'll try to help with our platform to do whatever we can.
Yeah. And you know what? I mean, we've lost John Prine. We lost, I guess, the guy from Stacey's Mom. What's that band? Stacey's Mom's got it going on.
Not coming to me.
Adam Schillinger or something like that. I forget. But They died of this, you know, and that's when it really hits home. And by the way, Charlie Daniels died today.
So did Ennio Morricone, right? So we lost a couple greats out there today. Yeah. So Charlie Ennio.
But anyways, I don't want to get into it. Let's talk about Hendrix, I guess. I mean, you're the host.
Yeah, but we're coming to the end, man. So what do you want to talk about next week? Have you thought about it? Or you thought of any guests you want to bring on?
I mean, what I was thinking about is this. You know what? I mean, I don't know, man. I mean, you want to talk in the Zappa? Maybe you want to go Ike's era? I'd like to hear, like, I want you to educate everybody. I'm sure you've done this before. If you haven't done this before, Michael, talk about the Flo and Eddie era. Because you know what?
I did a full show on the Flo and Eddie era.
There we go. All right. Okay. You want to go? How about we go? Mother's Invention? I can do that.
All right. Well, we'll take it offline and come up with some fun topics for that. You're going to be in Long Beach? You're going to be at your same place next week?
Yeah, I'll be here in Long Beach. But you know what? Okay. When I'm on the 20th, it's going to be funny. I'm going to be in Dallas on a four-hour layover. So I think we can probably do it from Fort Worth, Dallas International at the bar. What do you think?
Find the bar. Yeah, get a booth.
We'll
get a booth,
man. Would that be awesome?
Find someone cool to have as a guest. You know, you got to do your op-ed research in the beginning. Have a drink and walk around for a half hour.
I'll do it. Okay, so what do you want to talk about next week, man? What do you want to talk about?
Well, I don't know, man. We have to see what happens in our lives between now and then.
Because we're always in touch. We're always in touch. And I want to give a shout-out to my fiance. Miss Karen, you know, she's really big on Beale Street. You know, now they're going to get back singing and rehearsing. She's on the brink of doing a Miles Davis's old wife, Betty Davis, I brought up earlier, a tribute. So we're going to work on that when she comes to L.A. in September with me.
All right.
But you know what? That's what I do to the women who love me. And she could. Hey, you know what? You got to come to Memphis, bro.
Yeah.
She cooks the best green bean casserole. Oh, dude, all from scratch. It's to the point where I can't even go in the kitchen without her throwing stuff. It's awesome.
I've been to Mud Island in Memphis, but I haven't done the actual town. So,
yeah. But you know what? Southern food's great. I love the South, you know, and people there are great. And God, you got Mississippi within a stone's throw away, and you got Arkansas and the food of Missouri. You can be within there in 45 minutes. It's beautiful. It's awesome. God's country out there. You know, and I believe Memphis is booming, but after COVID, man, people are kind of heading for the hills a little bit, protecting themselves. But you know what? If you do things the right way, you know, good things come to you. And that I'm a big believer of that, you know, and I really love this show, and I can't wait to see you next week, bro. And we'll talk during the week.
Yeah, man. Thanks. So thanks for everything, Jamie. Thanks for coming on. Welcome.
Yeah.
It's going to be a good time. I think we're going to have a long future of fun ahead.
We're going to get some guests. Oh, by the way, we got some. I don't know if I can say this, but I'm going to say it. You know, I want to say a shout out to Crystal, our intern. I just hired her yesterday. You were with her. We're on the 101 freeway. I go, I got one. I got a live one. And I threw the phone to you. So, yeah, Crystal's going to be great. She's going to be helping us a little bit. And plus, she knows some women that love music that happen to be adult film stars.
Uh-oh. Salacious.
So we're going to bring a little bit of L.A. and a little bit of, realness to you. But yeah. I will brief them. Make sure they ain't stripping in front of the camera. We don't want to lose our license.
YouTube will kick us off of here, man.
Yeah, but they can do it in the studio because no one's going to know. I'm just kidding. But anyways, no, but what I'm saying is, like, you know, I see a big future with you. I think you got a great demeanor. You got a lot of sense. Man. And not just that, you're intelligent. And you know what? You rock and roll it.
Oh, shucks, bro.
I say, you're just like me. I go, dude, call him now, now. I don't want to. But that's how we roll, bro. And you know what? But you know what? Hey, you're a great family man. I've seen your Facebook. We've talked. And you know what? You're a good man, Michael. But you know what?
I feel
you're
like we're
still a New Yorker.
Yeah,
so
well,
fuck
you know what?
You.
Well, peace and love from my end there, brother. So I take that. I think that we're bridging a gap in the musical time-space continuum. Right, I think that you had an experience, and I'm a few years behind you, but we're 90% on the same line.
Fish. You tell me about Fish, and you tell me about these other bands. I'm going, I've heard of them. I don't know, because my daughter is a big Arctic Monkey fan. My other daughter's a big country music fan. Mm-hmm. So it's like she's up in Fresno, but the Arctic Monkey fan, she tells you about everything, you know? Dude, how cool is this? She's from Blackburn, Lancashire. In England, it's like, isn't there a damned alive about that? The 4,000 hole. That's where my daughter's from.
That's cool as hell.
And she's got the accent and everything. She calls me Dom, Dom. And she's tough as hell. She does not put up with any crap. She's a total Brit, man, from the North.
We got to get her on here and chat.
We'll get her on, man. And I want to get the guru on, too.
Yeah.
He's got a lot to say, man. He's a very spiritual guy. We're going to get him on, Davey. And, you know, we're going to go to Topanga and, you know, burn fucking incense and talk to the spirits, man, because I need it.
There you go. Go commune, brother. Commune with the one.
Yeah, right.
Awesome, man. This has been a lot of fun. Go do your thing. I'll do mine. We'll see you again next week. We'll be talking, I'm sure, between then.
I'll be talking to you probably about a half an hour.
Okay. All right, hey, so thanks, everybody, for watching. Stay tuned. And there it is, episode 29, in the books with my new Monday co-host, Jamie Martinez.
I hope I did you well. I think I did pretty damn good, but you know, me. That's my ego. So, you know, crush it a little bit.
We'll talk after. Take care, everybody. Okay, have a good one. Guys.